McLaughlin. Here.
Join me in the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Minutes of meeting number 12-93-94, held February 14, 1994. May I have a motion to accept?
So move.
Second.
All those in favor? 7-0, thank you. Right here, we have a spot for citizens' discussion of any items not on the agenda. So if you've got anything at all to say that's not on the agenda, why, we'll welcome you up to the podium now. If you haven't, we'll move right along. Reports and correspondence.
I have one.
Councilor Jordan.
I have one thing that I guess I'll throw out, so if anybody's interested. They're going to have a week of open house for the new Cumberland County Jail, and they're going to have some activities, which is, well, number one, if you was interested and you wanted to sleep over one night at the jail, you're welcome to do it. And a dinner is going to be included, so they're going to feed you good. And Saturday, at 9 o'clock, they're going to have the ribbon cutting and the real ceremony. And that's on, lost my note. That's on the, gee, don't say, I think it's the 14th, but not.
Of April?
Of April, yes.
Good. Thank goodness I'm out of town.
Oh, you don't want to sleep over it again? I heard the other day that our town manager was going to sleep over, so I think that was pretty interesting. So I just wanted to throw it out if anybody's interested. There'll be some other publications and other information.
Thank you, Councilor Jordan. Any other reports? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councilor Jordan's a hard act to follow here. At the February meeting of the Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee, we did have Jerry Daigle, the Cape assessor, speak to the group. And I just think the councilors need to hear how well-received and well-respected Jerry is when he does appear before groups outside of this community. And that was a very informative presentation that he did for GPCOG. Second report is about the NLC Annual Congressional City Conference that Councilor Coggesell and Mr. McGovern and I have returned from at different times last night with adventures with the traveling. This is held annually in Washington, D.C., and it's an opportunity for municipalities to be represented down there and have visits to the congressional delegation. Between the three of us, we went to a good variety of sessions. This included Councilor Coggesell and I were able to attend one of the pre-conference seminars on leadership assessment, which was, I think we both found very interesting. I've been assessing some of our fellow councilors, and we'll further that later on. I knew you'd like that, Mr. Chairman.
We're not going to let you go to those things anymore.
Oh, really? It was a good learning experience to learn more about your own leadership style and management style, which was very valuable for me, anyway. Some of the other sessions included the Information Superhighway, one session on takings, safety in the community, and the national health care reform. We also attended meetings with the congressional delegation, all four of the members, at various times. But it's just, I know some people had made comments because there was an article in the Cape Courier about this, that's why tonight's meeting is on a Wednesday rather than a Monday, because of our attendance at this meeting. And I certainly feel it's a very worthwhile experience. It's the first time I, as a counselor, have gone to this particular NLC conference. Did find it worthwhile. It's a very good time to make sure you continue your national perspective on issues and how the federal government actions impact the local government. I also need to say that MMA does a very good job in preparing materials ahead of time that are sent down to the various members of the delegation. Not all the state municipal leagues do that, and some of the others were fairly impressed when I was telling them what we were able to do. So our delegation was, they knew what we were coming in to talk about. We weren't going in cold, and they were just sitting there being polite. We had some very pointed sometimes on discussions with the members, and I found MMA was very savvy along those lines. I also want to commend our manager. I know he likes to go to the Washington conference, and he has a very high reputation down there. Saw him in action talking with the congressional delegation. His reputation along those lines is very well earned. And I want to thank the council and the citizens for the opportunity that Phyllis and Mike and I had to attend this.
Thank you. Any other reports or correspondence? Moving right along. Item number 138. To consider approving a request from the Papuda Club to operate games of chance on April 8, 1994 at the Papuda Club and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, I'd ask that I step down on this issue as a member of Papuda Club.
Certainly. You ready? You're taking that?
I thought Deb was.
Deb was. Ms. Lane, will you start us off?
Thank you. In your packet, you should have received a copy of the application. This will be at the Papuda Club on 300 Sproink Avenue on April 8th. These will include Wheel of Fortune, Blackjack 1 and 2, High-Low Dice, Chuck-a-Luck. This evening, Mr. DiOrio, the manager of the Papuda Club, is here to answer any questions. I would recommend that you authorize the signing of these applications.
May I have a motion?
I move we grant the application.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor? 6-0. Thank you.
That's easier than getting them in Calais.
I must have gone out of my
He's happy, aren't you? Item number 129. Tabled from 2/14/94. To consider granting a quick claim deed to Kimberly A. and Robert C. Davis for property located at 340 Ocean House Road and taking any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman, I ask that because of a perceived conflict that I be excused from participating in this item.
Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This item has resolved itself since the last meeting. It is on the agenda because you did table it to this meeting. The mortgage that the notice hadn't been sent for was subsequently assigned to another party through a legal transfer. The other party paid the taxes for the year in which the foreclosure was pending, and I would recommend that you table this item indefinitely.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded.
Take it from the table.
All those in favor?
No. I have a question. Thank you. I guess based on the reports I've read, I'd just like to know how I can owe 60 and or whatever it was and come up and pay 13, and how do I do that?
Good question. What the policy is that if, in fact, a foreclosure has actually occurred, we require a property owner or a former property owner in that case to pay all of the taxes that are owed, not only for the year in which or the period in which the foreclosure occurred, but all subsequent taxes thereafter, including if they pay it after April 1st of the year for the taxes due the following October and the following May. In this particular case, the taxes that were due, that were to be foreclosed upon, were for the fiscal year 91-1992. It was only the second half of that payment. Therefore, they're only required under the law to pay the portion that would have been foreclosed upon, which in this case was one half of 1 year.
And we can expect the rest in the years to come, one way or another.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
We have a motion. Is it seconded?
It was seconded, Mr. Chairman. I don't know if this is still on the table. I think we need a primary motion to remove it from the table so we can take this action in case anybody questions us Robert's rules in the future.
So
I would move to take it from the table.
Second.
Yes. All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you.
Then I would move to table it indefinitely.
All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. 139. To consider a recommendation from the Cape Elizabeth Historical Preservation Committee
to utilize funds from the Spurwink Church Fund to install a new carpet at the church and take any necessary action. Do we have a motion?
Nope. Nobody got any comment other than what's in our memo?
The chairman's here, would like to speak. The chairman of the committee would like to speak.
Yeah, okay. We're getting into the discussion period, won't we? Yeah, if we get there. We have a motion on this one?
Yes, so move.
Second.
All right, moved and second. The discussion. May we hear from the chairman of the committee, please?
Hi, I am Ann Foden, and I did submit to you a letter explaining a little bit about what we've been going through. We have chosen a carpeting for the church. It is expensive. But we've worked with historical people within the state, and they've suggested a wool carpeting to keep in line with the church. And a lot of legwork has been done, a lot of effort. And we recommend this particular carpeting. I did bring a sample, and I'll show it to you. And in comparison to what's out there, it's the least expensive choice, too, as far as the wool carpeting goes. And we felt that a solid color was the best choice. We looked into other options as far as having the floors refinished, but the pews, part of the problem is the pews can't be moved because we believe they were put down and then the floors were laid, or the floor that's there now. So, and also historically, it wouldn't be right to move them. So we're working around the pews. So to have it installed, it works out to the number that was on the form that I sent to you, which is steep. But we think it also will be done right. It's a very high-quality carpet. And we felt also that in looking into the refinishing, getting back to that, that it was too piecemeal, and we were unable to do that. And that also would have been extremely expensive working around the pews. So I'll just pass, if anyone's interested, I'll pass this on. It's a sample of the carpet. And it's also the estimate that breaks it down a little bit more. Are there questions, or have I answered any?
Questions. Councilor Dahlberg.
And this depletes pretty much at least down to $2,000, the Spurwink Church Fund. Is that going to have any future implication?
That is true. And our group did talk about that, and we felt that this money was allocated quite a while ago, and it really was supposed to be used to improve the church, so we felt good about that. But we agree that there's not going to be a lot left in it. And one of our goals for the upcoming year is to put together a Friends of the Spurwink Church and try to replenish that fund and continue to fundraise and try to build it.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I see one of my answers on there, but for the public's information, who will be the vendor for this?
It is Mogulian Carpets in Scarborough. So we tried to keep it local, and the other big piece is the carpeting is up now, too. So, and the weddings start in May, so they are saying that it will be done by May 1st.
I wanted to know the time. How long do they expect the job to take?
It takes 3 to 4 weeks to get the carpeting here. It is made in California.
I see.
And it will be sent. And they're absorbing the freight charge. And then it takes 1 to 2 weeks for the vendor, for the installer. His name is Ed Fortier, and he'll be putting it in. That's who works with this company.
Any other questions? Councilor O'Neill?
Yes. I'm just curious, are there any other maintenance projects sort of on the back burner or something? I mean, if we spend it here, what's, you know?
Yes, a few years ago, a survey was done on the building, and a list was put together, a prioritized list. And really, we looked it over with a fine-tooth comb, and there's really nothing major that has to be done right now. Another one of our goals is to have that building survey revisited and to make any changes and to kind of reevaluate that and put it back in order as far as priorities. There's nothing major right now. I don't know if that answered your question, but for example,
how's
like screens,
roof?
We want
the
screens.
Roof?
Pretty good. Yeah. And structurally, they say things are in pretty good shape. So.
Thank you.
Okay. Councilor Jordan.
Has anybody looked up and see if the pigeons are living in the cubalola, or they're just on the roof. I understand from somebody up there a couple of years ago that they were living there. That's why I was wondering. I think it should be wired up and closed off if they are.
Yeah, that is something that's come up. I've talked to Mike about that, and we think that it's under control now, but that's something prior to the first wedding to check that again. Maybe the town can go double-check that.
We had no chicken wire put on the inside of the louvers, but the chickens still are attracted to the sight of the chickens.
I don't know if you should have gone to Washington.
I don't want to eat at your house, Mike. I know that.
Well, you get my point in it.
Yeah, we knew what you meant.
Any other questions? Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Item number 140. To consider a request from the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust to accept a conservation easement over land situated between Route 77 and Fowler Road and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust is offering a very generous easement to the community. They recently acquired some land from Mrs. Poole and Mrs.
Richardson,
Rosalind Richardson and Vicki Poole. Located off Route 77. They did receive it free and clear. In order to have it protected long term, they would like to have conservation restrictions placed over the property. They have approached the town to see whether or not the town would be willing to hold those conservation restrictions. They have had a number of discussions with Nat Clifford, an officer of the Land Trust, over the last few months about this. It has been fully reviewed by the town's attorney, and I would recommend that you accept this conservation easement subject to final approval and language and drafting by the town attorney. There's some minor salutations, including how the deed is notarized. It's totally, it's not substantial at all on what the changes are. Here representing the Land Trust, in addition to Mr. Clifford, are Dr. Peter Rand, I believe a member of the board still of the Land Trust, and Randy Blake, who is the president of the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust.
May I have a motion, please?
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept this easement pending approval by the town attorney of the language in the deed.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Dalbeck.
Yeah, as I look at this piece of land, I guess I'm at a little bit of a loss to understand its value of this to anybody other than the property owners adjacent to it. I mean, this seems to be a piece of land that leads no place. Certainly, if I was an adjacent property owner, I'd be absolutely delighted that this has been removed from anything that might have any impact, and now I can utilize the property. I've just expanded my own lot, and I guess I'm a little concerned about why this whole thing has taken place, and in the long term, the tax implications that this might have had. And I realize that it's probably already off the rolls, having gone over to the Land Trust, but I'm a little lost at maybe not, I don't know. I need a little help.
To answer, I think, both of your implied questions. First, as far as the interests of the adjacent property owners, the reason that the town might be interested in this particular lot is that we do own the lot that's northerly of this particular lot. It's a section we own, as you look at your map, 13A, on both sides of Ocean House Road. So what this does, it creates a wooded area and a sort of a natural preserve that, you know, will exist in perpetuity. And that's why it's of interest to the town, other than, you know, any lot anywhere. It's the fact that it does create a 6-acre parcel in that particular location, which 6 acres for conservation purposes has a lot more value than, you know, just a simple smaller parcel would. Second, the tax consequences of this is that when the Land Trust holds it in fee simple without any restrictions on it, as it now would be, The town assessor would assess it as that, as a land that is available for development. Once the conservation restrictions are placed on the land, it will receive much more favorable valuation treatment from the assessor, probably at a rate of, you know, this is a guess, but 15% of what the taxes might otherwise be. So there is a cost to the community in terms of lost tax revenue, foregone tax revenue, but at the same time, the use of the land is restricted.
I guess maybe what I'm feeling is that we need more of a policy of what we pick up as land and what we don't pick up as land, so that we don't end up with a patchwork quilt of land here and there, which doesn't have any particular value to the town and to the citizens.
Just to clarify, we're not actually picking up this piece of land. It'll still be owned by the land trust. We'll have an easement.
Right, but, you know, same type of thing. It is going to cost us money to vote yes.
Yes, we will have foregone revenue. Of an amount to be determined, the assessor will look at this April 1st. We'll look at the restrictions on it as of April 1st, and we'll make a judgment at that point in time.
Councilor Coggeshall.
Would it be beneficial to have someone tell us how this relates to the green belt?
I think Mr. Clifford's willing to do that, Chairman, the interim.
Nat Clifford, Director of the Land Trust. Responding to the green belt issue and also to Mr. Dahlbeck's comments, the directors of the Land Trust are as concerned as you are about picking up parcels of land sort of scattered about. We're responsible for them. We pay taxes on them. I also might add that there is a legal determination that indicates the Land Trusts are not responsible for property taxes on land that they own. We've never questioned that. We believe we should pay taxes and voluntarily do so, although I believe we could be exempt if we push the issue. In accepting any parcel, we go through the same thought process that you were, and this one we feel does fit in. We worked very hard to get access to Great Pond, finally acquired the Jordan land through a fundraiser and outright purchase, but the direction that this land is in, it's I think, would you say, Peter, a third of a mile from the intersection down here, might well have been the direction that we would have gone into Great Pond had other parcels adjacent been available. So there is other land that we hope someday we may be able to acquire. And we do find that if you have a toehold in an area, it does make it easier sometimes to talk to then adjacent property owners and convince them that they too should join the effort to make their land available. Assuming that the downside of it, that we're not successful in acquiring any more land in this area, this parcel does represent a piece of open space on a major highway in town that if it's left as it is, I think we'll certainly add in terms of just the view properties of the parcel, and that's written into this conservation easement. The green belt in a conceptual mode is not that specific as you go through different areas of the town. And again, I think someday this parcel, if we can acquire adjacent land, would lend itself very well to accessing from new Route 77 into some of the back land and eventually, hopefully, maybe down to Great Pond. So it's a beginning of more than just an isolated 3.5 acres.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you. Perhaps, Nat, you can answer these. Has the baseline data inventory
not yet
done yet?
No.
And when is that to be accomplished?
I would think later in the spring. certainly when we can get on the land without waders or scuba diving equipment. But we're getting a little bit better organized about surveying the parcels we have. We do have baseline data on all the parcels and would like to update that information and be a little bit more aggressive about that. And I think we've reached a point where we're doing things like establishing an endowment fund and developing more information on the parcels we have. And I think perhaps getting better organized at trying to put together adjacent parcels also on all the holdings that we have.
I heard the manager say that the town attorney has reviewed the deed and is comfortable with it. And I will accept that. I just had a bit of discomfort. There was a little loose in some of the deed description, and I'm never really comfortable. I like it to be a little tighter than it was. It was just not as tight, you know. We have
Are you talking now the language in the easement?
I'm talking about the deed description
of
the parcel, which is basically your concern, I guess. So maybe it's a moot point, and I better just be quiet then. If you folks were willing to accept.
Well, it's the meets and bounds description has come forward through previous deeds, and we're just incorporating that in our present deed, the one that was presented to us.
Okay. Historic. You can tell it's an historical deed, some of the language. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome. Other questions? Thank you, Mr. Clerk. So moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-1. Thank you.
Whoops.
7-1? 7-0.
Thank you.
I got eight of us here. I keep thinking Mike's on the council. Item number 141, to consider a recommendation from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission to approve several requests for uses of Fort Williams Park during 1994 and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, I'll briefly highlight the uses. The Cape Elizabeth High School graduation, of which there are two students and the principal here to represent, that would be on June 11th, a Saturday at 2 p.m. Cape Elizabeth Family Fun Day, Saturday, June 18th, 1994, with a rain date of June 19th. A fairly large event on September 23rd and 24th, particularly on the 24th, the Antique Automobile Club of America, who would have 500 cars on site. This was extensively reviewed by the Fort Williams Commission, as were all of these, and recommended. The Portland Symphony Orchestra on Friday, July 1st. The British Car Show, which is becoming an annual tradition, on Sunday, September 11th, with a rain date of the following Sunday. You can see on the back of your sheet are all the different events that have either thus far been approved or are now pending for Fort Williams Park this particular season. All these events are recommended by the Fort Williams Advisory Commission with the fees indicated. Basically, they're looking for a $3 fee if there's an entered vehicle type event where there's so many cars in a show, so much per the vehicle, and then for an event where there's simply a lot of vehicles coming in, it'd be a $2 per vehicle entrance fee. And the Antique Automobile Club, kind of a mix of the two, both the higher fee for the entered vehicle and then a fee for the vehicles coming into the fire station lot. And it's the intent is to collect the fee for that particular event for those attending that event and not the people that would just be coming in and going to the lighthouse or whatever. It would only be for the parking for that event.
Thank you. May I have a motion, please?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
As a member of the Portland Symphony Board of Trustees, I'll have to step down on this issue also.
Gosh, I don't know whether we let you go twice in the same day.
You're setting for us.
May I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion.
I think the high school students may like to address this.
Thank you. Come right down.
My name is Siri Fowler. Martha Wiley. We're members of the 1994 graduation committee, and right now we're trying to get the use of Fort Williams for our graduation. You mentioned earlier that graduation was going to be at 2 p.m., but right now we're having a conflict with that because of some athletic events that are going to be taking place on the 11th. There's a chance that some of the seniors will be participating in those events, so right now we're considering either moving graduation back a couple hours and move it later, a couple hours into the afternoon, and the senior class is going to vote on that tomorrow in our class meeting. We want to use Fort Williams because a lot of the other classes have. We find it a nice facility to be used. It's out in the fresh air in Cape Elizabeth in a nice spot on the ocean, and it's just something that everybody in the class enjoys.
Thank you.
Sounds good.
Sounds good. I would trust we can accommodate you.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I did talk with Bob Malley today about the graduation timing and what kind of discussion there had been in the Fort Williams committee about this. It was Bob's feeling that, you know, the committee approved it for 2 o'clock, knowing that they had to have set up time earlier in the day. They were going to have a discussion with a representative from Little League about any possible conflicts with Little League that day. That's happening this year because it's a Saturday graduation, which has not happened in the past. It's usually been a Friday graduation. And I'm assuming the Little League potential conflict either has been or is going to be resolved fairly easily. And we'll say to you ladies, yes, we're certainly going to let you graduate. If it turns out you have to have it down at the soccer field, that works too. You still graduate and you have a good time. Hopefully that will not happen this year. We don't know who's in charge of weather yet. But I think the intent of the Fort Williams committee, I don't want to speak for them, but hopefully their intent was for the seniors to have it available to them for the entire day so they could do their setup properly, regardless of the time of graduation. And I hope we can assume that our approval tonight, if it's voted on, would include that intent.
Thank you, Councilor.
Just the commission made absolutely clear that this was to take precedent over Little League on that particular day.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Any other questions? All those in favor? 7-0, thank you.
6-0, please.
6-0, you didn't vote?
We had somebody.
Oh, I had you out, yeah. I forget, I'm only going to let you go once in a time now, from now on. To consider a request from the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Unit to solicit funds later this year for a replacement rescue unit and take any necessary action. Item number 142.
Yes, the rescue unit is coming before you to raise funds. They're very ably represented this evening by Richard Groton, who is the captain of the rescue unit. And I also note in the audience the attendance of the longtime treasurer of the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Unit, Henry C. Adams.
Go right ahead, sir.
Good evening. We've included a letter in your packet this week requesting an opportunity for the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Company 3 of the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department to go to the public in September for a community-wide fundraising effort to raise approximately $50,000 to be joined with savings of the rescue company over the last 9 years since our last purchase of a rescue. We anticipate being able to include about $25,000 from our savings toward the purchase of this unit. Rescue units have become much more sophisticated over the last 9 years since our last purchase. Purchase prices are going up, but I think the town is going to get a much more serviceable vehicle. So we're looking for a community-wide fundraiser to begin right after Labor Day, probably that following week. We would have letters in the homes explaining that the rescue unit is all volunteer, that we exist solely on the contributions of those that we serve, and those contributions go to purchase both our supplies and go into savings. And ultimately, if we have money left, which we do, that will be contributed toward the purchase of the new unit as well. There are no fees charged to any resident or guest in Cape Elizabeth that needs transportation to a medical facility. We serve the 3 area hospitals of May Medical Center, Brighton Medical Center, and Mercy Hospital, and no invoice is ever received for transportation. We are an emergency medical transfer unit, which means that we don't take patients from their home to a doctor's office or to the hospital for routine examinations, but we do function on an emergency basis and handle approximately 400 plus calls every year with about 28 members. I think the letter in the packet gave you a lot of detail. I'd be happy to entertain any questions you may have.
Any questions? Please. Councilor Jordan.
Oh, I just have a offhand comment on how we got this letter, and as far as the public is concerned, a lot of the public, they don't really understand how much that donations have gone to the rescue over the year, being saved and applied to a new unit. And I think that something like that should be pointed out some way or another, whether we want to. I don't think we ought to have it in the motion, but I think when you get your publicity part of it, in my opinion, that something like that should be pointed out to the people.
That was in the letter that we sent for our last fundraiser in 1986, and that information would be included in this fundraiser as well, explaining to people that we do save our contributions and that we're very frugal with them.
So when you get ready to go out for your fundraiser, you're going to send a letter similar to this or this letter. Is that right? Okay.
Councilor Coggeshall.
Have you considered approaching the Cape Courier with an article pertaining to this fundraising and background information?
Sure.
I've been recently somewhat acquainted with ambulance services, and the citizens of this town don't realize what a benefit they get by having you all on as volunteers.
We have been working with our membership to get, I hope, as many as a dozen of our members to write articles about the rescue unit from the volunteers' perspective that would appear in the Cape Courier over the next several months, explaining many things. What's it like to be a volunteer? What's it like when the pager goes off at 2 a.m.? What kinds of calls do we go on? What kinds of things do we encounter? What kind of services do we render, and how have things become more complex now than they were, say, 15 years ago? You will be seeing a lot of information about the rescue.
Councilor Dalbeck.
You folks are great, and I certainly heartily support your effort here in getting a new vehicle. I've made this comment before, but I still just wish, with the federal government being so liberal under Medicare and passing out funds for ambulance services, somehow we ought to be able to tap that without also hitting up the people of Cape Elizabeth. I've had a mother-in-law who's been hauled to the hospital, I don't know how many times, not from Cape Elizabeth, but, you know, his ambulance service is making a fortune. And, you know, we're doing it free. And I just hate to see everybody else benefiting from the generosity of the federal government. Just a comment.
I understand.
It's something to think of.
Sure. I think it's a point well taken that our membership, 28 people, do these calls on a day in and day out basis, with the town really supporting us through gas, garage, maintenance, and dispatch services. Really is a great tribute to the people that are serving currently.
It certainly is.
And also to the people that aren't here this evening that have served in the past. We tend to forget them, but there are hundreds of people that have been on thousands of rescue calls over the year. They deserve the credit.
It's a great crew.
Thank you.
Councilor McLaughlin.
I just want to add my kudos to the rescue unit. One of my daughters had occasion to be served by one of your members after a car accident last spring, and I was very thankful you guys were there.
Thank you.
Any other questions, comments? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman. I will return your comments to the rescue. They'll be very pleased. Thank you.
May I have a motion, please?
Make a motion that we pass it.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 143, to consider a report from the Planning Board regarding changes in the zoning ordinance, which would have the Zoning Board of Appeals review and decide sewer appeals and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, this is the one final piece of the restructuring of the boards and commissions that was reviewed by the council earlier this year. It was discovered that this particular portion of it, since it did amend the zoning ordinance, did have to be referred to the Planning Board, and then a public hearing had to be held subsequent to that. So I would encourage you to schedule a public hearing on these proposed amendments for your regular April meeting.
Thank you. May I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we set this for public hearing. Is that correct, Mr. McGovern? 7:30 on April 11th, 1994.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
Mr. Chairman, I just have a question of the manager. In a couple of instances, it mentions the sewer superintendent.
Yes.
Who is that?
It's the Director of Public Works.
Thank you.
Other questions? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 144, to consider referring to the Finance Committee the proposed fiscal year 1995 municipal, school, and special fund budgets and take any necessary action. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion?
Just one point. The special funds budgets you'll find, for those that have the big book in front of them this evening, in the back of it.
In addition to this copy in our packet.
Did you get two? No. You can turn in one set, so we'll have them.
Right now.
Whatever.
Any other questions?
One other point. If citizens do wish copies of the budget summary, they are available in the town office.
Thank you. Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 145, to consider the acceptance of a gift of a lot off Loxley Road from Dennis J. and Catherine M. Slattery and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes. This is a little bit like the previous one, except that there are no restrictions, no conservation easements. It's an unrestricted deed. The reason why this particular lot is important to the community is the fact that we own to the rear of this approximately 50 acres that extends all the way up to that was given to us by Robert Taylor and I believe Ibis Corporation as a result of the original Stonegate development. That particular piece only has a very small right-of-way that extends out into Shore Road at about the brow of the hill. It also does extend out onto Loxley Road, just northerly, again, of the lot, the 150-foot lot line that you see. What this does, it gives us a, sort of a beachhead, if you'll pardon the expression, within the Sherwood Forest neighborhood going into this whole much larger conservation area. You know, should we ever need any, you know, small shed or anything to support an activity within that conservation area that is totally restricted as to what can be done on it. There might be minor possibilities on this lot, but it's a very deep lot. It's unbuildable. It's difficult, but it does give us a much more additional frontage on Loxley Road and a much better possibility of getting equipment in for maintenance onto the conservation area, you know, into the generations ahead.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Any questions for the manager? Entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept this gift of a lot of land on Loxley Road if presented tonight.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion?
One more point I did wish to make. The Slatteries have indicated that they are going to convey this to us. We had the appraisal done on it. Even after the appraisal, they indicated they would. We still don't have, and if the minutes would reflect this, the signed deed in hand, and this would simply authorize me to accept it upon its execution and have it filed in the registry.
Any questions?
Is that part of the motion? You were given the authority to accept, sign the deed?
Give the manager authority to accept the deed.
Seeing none, all those in favor? 7-0, thank you. Item number 146, how are we on 146? Mr. McGovern?
Yes, the tree warden asked for this item to be placed on the agenda so it would come up later in the meeting.
Oh.
He's prepared an exceptional report and will be arriving shortly, I would imagine, to present it. But it's a complete inventory of all the trees in Cape Elizabeth that are publicly owned and I think just a tremendous resource for tree planting and... I'm not an expert on trees, so I'm not about ready to explain it. So.
If you read that, you will become an expert.
You will. Well,
yes.
That's a very complete report.
Will somebody move that we adjourn for 5 minutes?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? We're adjourned. We hope that he comes.
Under his thought.
Oh, my God.
Item number 147.
Wait a minute.
We have to vote on it.
Wait a minute.
We should receive the report. Accept the report.
We can still accept
it. We should accept the report. I think that's a good idea because we have it, don't we?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a motion on accepting the tree warden's report. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor of accepting the report? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 147, to consider entering into executive session to discuss property acquisition, disposition, and take any necessary action. Councilor Coggeshall.
Mr. Chairman, I have recently discovered that I may have a perceived conflict on this particular issue, and so I ask to be excused from this session.
Don't go away, though. We might have something else.
Cheap way of getting home early.
May I have a motion,
Mr. Chairman,
please?
Do we want to just say that we will have citizen discussion before we go into executive session?
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
Any citizen that would like to discuss any item on tonight's agenda that hasn't had a chance to, please now speak.
Someday, Lisa. Yes,
Ms. Brown.
Yeah, I wanted to speak very briefly about something not on the agenda, and that's this past month we lost three Cape Elizabeth citizens who had given a tremendous amount to the community. First, Ralph Gould, for whom the Community Service Award is named. Who was extremely generous with the Spurring Church over the years and in numerous other endeavors. Second was Evelyn Jordan, who, if you look at the members of his family, his daughters have served on some of our commissions. His son, Stevie, is our tree warden.
Harbor master.
Yeah, it's one of those nights.
A
harbor master. His sons-in-laws have been on the council. And it's just his brother Lester served on the council. And it's just amazing when you look at that entire family. And it all seems to stem from Evelith and Ginny, and you know their father Ramey on all that they've done for this community. And Evelith's loss was a real passing. And the third is Ernie Jordan. Ernie was a dispatcher for the town for over 18 years, and was someone always used to come to the firemen's suppers meetings and always enjoyed speaking with him. Ernie's son Dick served with Billy on the council for quite a number of years, and a tremendous guy. And it's a real loss for the community and all three. And you know, it just seems to happen. These things happen in cycles. There was a time again. You know, I think this is the second time this year I've made mention of some of the losses of the community in this. Was one that was particularly, felt within the community.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. Now may I have a motion to go into executive session?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. We're in executive session, or will be.
We really should have made comment on Michael's tie. I think Michael is staying out all night tonight. He's got his green tie on.
You think that's Patrick's day?
Huh?
Is that what's causing my slipping of the
Mr. Chairman, you go.